So good evening, everybody. Today I will be discussing about mitral regurgitation. So mitral word was taken from the bishops word by bishops. So mitral apparatus constitutes normal mitral apparatus constitutes about what constitutes mitral wall annulus, mitral leaflets with commissure, chordae, tendinae, papillary muscles supporting the LV wall and support of the LV wall. Altogether, these things are called as mitral wall complex. So mitral regurgitation is the most commonly encountered clinically significant valvular disease. Its overall frequency is 1.7% in population-based studies reflects an increase from 0.5% in person aged from 45 to 54 years to 9.3 in those aged around 75 years and older. It was a study published in Lancet 2006. According to Euroheart survey on valvular heart disease, MR was the second most frequent single native valve disease and accounted for about 31.6% of patients. The most frequent etiology overall was degenerative heart valve disease followed by rheumatic heart disease, and most frequent etiology seeking for mitral wall replacement is mitral wall collapse, according to Euroheart survey. So this is a diagram of the normal mitral wall complex showing the papillary muscles, chordae, tendinae, anterior mitral leaflets, anterior mitral leaflet, posterior mitral leaflet, annulus. So something about mitral wall annulus. Mitral wall annulus is a fibroelastic ring. It measures around 10 centimeter in significance for circumference. It tackles a wall in a cone-like manner, and annulus is elliptical in shape in systole and circular in diastole. Changes in the mitral wall annulus causing the changes in the mitral effect in the mitral wall annulus is one of the causes for mitral regurgitation that I'll be discussing this later. Then mitral wall leaflets, there are two mitral wall leaflets, that is anterior mitral leaflet and posterior mitral leaflet. Anterior mitral leaflet is 1 mm thickness, triangular shape, has a continuity with aortic annulus, and it encircles around 1/3 of the annulus and covers 2/3 of the wall orifice area. While posterior mitral leaflet is quadrangular in shape and occupies 2/3 of the annulus and covers 1/3 of the wall area. Then chordae, chordae are primary chordae which attaches to the free edge of the leaflet, and secondary chordae which attaches to the mid section of the leaflet, and tertiary chordae which attach to the annulus. So different effects on the different chordae causes different etiology, so can lead to MR because of different etiology. There are approximately 12 chordae and per papillary muscle, and approximately 120 chordae are attached to the each cable. Then there are two papillary muscles, anterior papillary muscle and posterior papillary muscle. Anterior papillary muscle, the more important thing is it has a dual bed supply, OM from circumflex and supply from diagonal muscle has a single bed supply. And it receives from RC, posterior tegmental gland. Then coming to pathophysiology relating to the MR. In MR, almost 50% of the regurgitant volume is ejected into left atrium before the aortic wall opens. The volume of MR flow depends on the regurgitant orifice area and pressure gradient between the LA and LV. So larger the regurgitant orifice area, more the flow of the MR, and greater the pressure difference between the LV and LA, greater the flow of the MR. So pressure gradient difference, pressure gradient depends on the systemic vascular resistance, and the regurgitant orifice area depends on the mitral annulus size. That is proportional to the preload and afterload, and inversely proportional to the contractility. It is also related to the murmur also, the timing of the murmur, the regurgitant orifice area that I will be discussing later. When the LV size is reduced by the treatment with positive inotropes, diuretics and vasodilator, the regurgitant orifice area is reduced and the volume of regurgitant flow decreases. stages of MR. They can be acute MR, then acute, then they can be chronic compensated MR without any symptoms, then they can be chronic decompensated MR. So for in acute MR, there is generally there is sudden increase in the there is sudden dysfunction of the MR leading to volume overload of the left ventricle, leading to increase in total stroke volume, which is a combination of forward stroke volume and percipient volume, and leads to increase in regurgitant stroke volume, forward stroke volume, and changes acute MR leads in regurgitant volume causes volume and pressure overload, which leads to increase in pulmonary venous hypertension, and which may lead to acute pulmonary edema. In chronic MR, the volume overload on LALV is usually is gradual and progresses over a certain time period, which leads to increase in LVDP and increase in left atrial pressure. But there is compensatory increase in the size of the LA also, and compensatory dilatation of the LV. So the symptoms are not much prominent in chronic compensated MR. The dilatation of the LV to accommodate the increased volume of the volume of LV, there is subsequent LV hypertrophy that is eccentric, and there is increased preload, then there is LV hypertrophy, there is reduced or normal afterload, which leads to which includes normal, which includes regurgitant volume over the time. Initially there is normal stroke volume, there is normal forward volume. However, as the MR increases in frequency, there is a reduction in forward stroke volume while increase in regurgitant volume, which leads to pulmonary congestion and pulmonary hypertension. MR and myocardial ischemia, generally the coronary flow rates are increased in patients with severe MR, and there is a mild increase in myocardial oxygen consumption as compared to AS and AR. So the clinical manifestation of myocardial ischemia is less seen in MR. Assessment of myocardial contractility in MR. So in early MR, there is increase in ejection volume, ejection phase and distance, such as which leads to increase in contractility and velocity of circumferential fiber shortening. However, when the decompensation of the MR takes place, the forward ejection fraction decreases and the regurgitant volume increases. However, the EF may remain normal to a certain period of time, but it generally signifies that there is severe decrease in the ejection ejection fraction. However, when the ejection fraction is decreased, it signifies there is irreversible impairment of the contractility and may further leads to myocardial, advanced myocardial dysfunction. Then hemodynamics related to severe MR. The effective forward cardiac output is reduced, as discussed earlier, which leads to decrease in functional capacity. The total LV output, though it is elevated, since the increase, there is increase in regurgitant flow volume, which leads to taller V waves and rapid by descent. Left atrial comprise left atrial comprises normal or reduced in acute MR. Left atrial is not able to compensate the acute the volume increase in the in acute MR. In severe long standard MR, there is markedly increased compliance because of massive enlargement of LA. Because of the well compensated large LA, the LA pressures are only slightly elevated, and pulmonary vascular resistance may be normal. However, when the associated because of the large LA, AF and associated AF may be present, and there is low cardiac output. With moderately increased compliance may occur in cases. Of severe in maybe occurred in severe decompensated chronic MR. So MR can also be classified according to the according to the leaflet motion that was given by Carpentier et al. According to him, there was type 1 is described as normal leaflet motion. Lesion associated with type 1 is annular dilatation and leaflet perforation or tear. It is generally seen in dilatic cardiomyopathy, endocarditis. Then type 2 is excess leaflet motion, which is lesion associated with it are elongation or rupture of chordae, elongation or rupture of papillary muscle, generally seen with degenerative wall disease associated with Marfan syndrome, fibroelastic deficiency, or Bardet's disease. It may be associated with the endocarditis, trauma, or ischemic cardiomyopathy.
Endodilatation can be seen with all post-strike crepitations also. All post-strike crepitations causing LALV volume overload can cause annular dilatation resulting in MR. That MR usually recovers once
we recover after treatment.
Then the LV size reduces. It usually comes down. Go ahead.
Then type 3A, that is because of restricted leaflet motion, both in systole and diastole. There is associated leaflet thickening or retraction. There may be associated leaflet calcification or may affect chordae, leading to thickening, retraction, or fusion of the chordae, generally seen in rheumatic heart disease or carcinoid heart disease. In type 3B, there is restricted leaflet motion, generally seen in systole only. It may be associated with LV dilatation on or aneurysm, may be associated with papillary muscle displacement or chordate tapering, generally seen in ischemic cardiomyopathy or dilated cardiomyopathy. So this is a
Mayank, how do you define mitral valve collapse?
The mitral valve collapse,
the
mitral valve collapse can be defined with the displacement with the displacement of mitral collapse. Primary mitrally a disease of the generally mitral valve contains atrial site or fibrosocyte. It is and a spongiform layer. In this mitral valve collapse, there is generally thickening of the and proliferation of this spongiform layer of the mitral leaflet and associated with the fibrous thickening of fibrous deposition of the atrial site, which leads to collapse of the mitral leaflet, and it is generally displacement of more than 5 mmc in mitral wall collapse.
Romila, correct? Romila? Mayank? Mohit, anyone?
Yes, sir.
Actually,
so when the displacement is above the transannular plane?
Above the annular hinge points. Okay?
Above
during
the
systole, more than 2 mm or thickness more than equal to 5 mm. Thickness of the leaflets. And it can be of either of the leaflets. Okay? So best view is also paracentral long axis.
Long axis.
तो उसमें यू कैन ड्रॉ अ लाइन एट द हिंज पॉइंट देन मूव स्क्रोल योर माइट्रल वॉल लीफलेट मूवमेंट्स see in systole whether it is going above the hinge point or not, and you can measure the thickness of the leaflet as well. ठीक है, चलो go ahead.
केवल जी मेटल के वॉल रिग मेटल रिग्रेशन के भी प्राइमरी और सेकेंडरी. तो प्राइमरी रिग्रेशन बिकॉज़ ऑफ मेबी ऑफ सिमेटिक ऑरिजिन फाइब्रोब्लास्ट डेफिशिएंसी रिलेटेड टू एलोडेनस सिंड्रोम एंड web associated myxomatous degeneration such as seen in Marfan syndrome, then there may be flame with MVP or causing mitral regurgitation secondary to vegetations or perforations. Secondary mitral regurgitation may be because of annular dilatation, calcification of annulus, then papillary muscle rupture secondary to acute MI. So in rheumatic MR, generally commissural fusion is seen. There is caudal shortening and fusion are more prominent. That is generally central. Fibrosis of caudae attached to the posterior wall is more frequent, and it is generally seen that it is reduced motion of the posterior leaflet in the diastole. There is generally semi-open posterior mitral leaflet seen throughout the cardiac cycle. And the motion of the anterior leaflet may produce a false sense of prolapse. In infective endocarditis, there is generally leaf destruction, perforation, or deformity, as there may be a large vegetation may be present, which may cause leaflet coaptation and lead to severe MR. So classification of mitral wall prolapse syndrome. Mitral wall prolapse syndrome mitral wall prolapse syndrome can occur in younger age, generally has a female preponderance. It has a thin leaflet with the systolic displacement, and it has a benign long-term course. Myxomatous mitral wall disease is generally seen in older age, generally between 40 to 70 years, with the male preponderance, and has a thickened redundant mitral and Wolff leaflet, and there is high likelihood of progressive disease. Then there may be secondary mitral wall prolapse, which may be associated with certain syndromes such as Marfan syndrome, Lord-Danlos syndrome, may be associated with HOCM and and certain other connective tissue disease such as osteogenesis imperfecta. So this is a diagram of normal mitral leaflet. So it has a atrialis portion that is thin and a smooth portion, while with towards the atrium, while there is a fibrosa portion of the mitral leaflet that is facing towards the ventricle. It is thick and has an attachment to caudate, and in between there is spongiosa layer. Spongiosa layer in mitral wall prolapse, it is generally seen that it is proliferation of the spongiosa layer, which further progresses and causes prolapse of the mitral wall. And later on in the disease, as the disease progresses, there may be fibrotic deposition over the atrialis side, and causing progression of the MR. This I have explained. Flail leaflet is generally due to myxomatous degeneration of the wall. There may be associated abnormal coaptation secondary to rupture of caudae. Posterior leaflet are more commonly involved in flail leaflet, and which leads to severe MR. Degree of MR is generally directly related to the extent of anatomical disruption, and eccentric jet of the MR is generally seen in the opposite direction of the leaflet involved. Then billowing mitral leaflet is generally defined by the mitral wall body that produces into left atrium below the hinge point, as we have discussed, that is more than 2 cm. MR is usually mild in this condition. Then floppy mitral wall, it is associated with thickening of the mitral wall, mitral leaflet, which is more with diastolic thickness of more than 5 mm. So this is a diagram showing different morphologies of the mitral regurgitation. So, this one is the normal leaflet. Plain leaflet, posterior field leaflet leads to, it leads to directed to the opposite side of the leaflet involved. Then there is single scalloped prolapse, which leads to coaptation of the, which leads to coaptation of leading to mitral regurgitation. Then there is bilateral thin prolapse, which leads to central central jet of mitral regurgitation. Then there could be functional mitral regurgitation because of secondary to the acute MI or dilatation of the LV or LV aneurysm. Then there may be associated myxomatous prolapse, generally seen secondary to the connective tissue disorders and Marfan syndrome, which has a central projecting jet. Then there may be associated leaflet motion, mainly seen in rheumatic heart disease, which is involving the posterior leaflet. Then there may be associated with the infective endocarditis. So these are the few echocardiographic views of the different etiologies of the mitral regurgitation. Then this is the tiger stripe appearance generally seen in MVP, which may be because of the oscillating tissue. With tiger stripes are because of the oscillating tissue during the during the regurgitant jet, as seen in this procedure. Then abnormality of the mitral wall annulus. Annular dilatation is generally.
So amongst all the echocardiographic features, plain leaflets are quite essential to identify.
Yes.
Because if someone has double plain leaflets, they will be most of the time defective coaptation and probably many a times ruptured chordae, and these candidates will be requiring surgery pretty soon.
Sir, वही सर जो इसकी natural history में mitral wall collapse is the most common etiology for patients requiring surgery, 30%. So annular dilatation may be because of dilated cardiomyopathy. Chronic AF may also lead to annular enlargement leading to MR. Then mitral annular calcification has generally seen in elderly, may be associated with in young patient, may be associated with hypertension and chronic kidney disease. There may be in short axis view, annular calcification can be focal or extensive, and may appear as a U-shaped posterior, may involve entire U-shape in posterior annulus. Region of anterior mitral leaflet and posterior aortic wall continuity is rarely involved. Mitral annular calcification is more common in women and associated with coronary or carotid atherosclerosis. Calcification of aortic wall cusp is associated with the mitral annular calcification in approximately 50% of the population. Then abnormalities of the chordae tendineae. Lengthening and rupture of chordae tendineae is generally seen in mitral wall collapse syndrome. Other causes are congenital infective endocarditis, rheumatic fever, posterior aneurysm, genesis imperfecta, and other connective tissue disorder. Caudate to posterior leaflet rupture is more frequent compared to anterior mitral leaflet. The idiopathic rupture of caudate is generally is pathognomonic of fibrosis of papillary muscle. Caudate rupture may also occur due to acute LV dilatation, and depending on the caudate and rate of rupture depends on the may be directly proportional to the severity of the MR. Papillary muscles, since papillary muscles are anterior papillary muscle is supplied by L6 and LAD, and posterior papillary muscle is supplied by RC. So the most commonly associated involvement of papillary muscle rupture secondary to ischemia is posterior papillary muscle. And papillary papillary muscle dysfunction, muscle involvement of the papillary muscles is directly related to the degree of the severity of them. Regional LV dysfunction with the abnormal contraction of the papillary muscle and or underlying ventricular wall. In patient with MI, myocardial scarring may also results in MR at rest. MR may be intermittent in the patient with inducible ischemia, and teethering of the wall closure resulting in appearance of tenting or teethering of mitral wall can be seen in system. So they may be associated with posterior lateral displacement of the papillary muscle. There may be apical leaflet cooptation, restricted leaflet closure, and mild regurgitation that is generally reversible. Then secondary mitral regurgitation may be because of involvement of mitral annulus dilatation, incomplete leaflet cooptation because of LA dilatation and LV dilatation. Annular dilatation is and diameter of mitral annulus is compared with the anterior leaflet and is measured in the diastole. So it is seen that annular dilatation is present when the annulus by anterior leaflet ratio is more than 1.3 or when the diameter of mitral annulus is more than 35 mm. As the normal mitral annular dimensions is only 10 mm, so more than 35 mm, it is and when it is when it is dilated. So drugs which are related to MR are fenfluramine, pergolide, cabergoline, fenfluorex, and leads to restriction of leaflet mobility. So clinical features associated with MR, patient may in chronic compensated MR, the patient may remain asymptomatic for years, though patient may complain of fatigue, that is because of low forward flow. They may be associated severe dyspnea, PND, orthopnea, which may occur in cases of acute MR, or may be associated with severe decompensated MR. Sudden death is generally seen, but it is very rare, and hemoptysis and systemic embolization are less common in MR as compared to MS. In mitral wall prolapse syndrome, patient may complain of syncope, desyncope, palpitation, and chest discomfort. Chest discomfort in MVP is generally associated with the tensioning of the papillary muscle. It is generally may give a picture of angina. But to differentiate it from angina, the chest discomfort in mitral wall prolapse is generally not associated with exertion. Palpitations in mitral wall prolapse generally occur because of the arrhythmias associated with it. It is generally seen that MVP may be associated with ventricular tachycardia or symptomatic brachyarrhythmias in some population. So on palpation, like BP is generally usually normal in such cases. In palpation, carotid obstruct is usually brisk. That helps in differentiating it from AS, in which the carotid obstruct is slow rising. Cardiac impulse, as with the arterial impulse, is generally brisk, and there is diffuse cardiac LV type of apex. On auscultation, S1 is generally soft but may be increased in rheumatic heart disease. S2 is generally wide split because there is early closure of the, because of decrease in forward cardiac output, there is early closure of the aortic wall, causing the wide split in the S2. There may be loud P2 in cases of if the patient is severe decompensated or acute mitral regurgitation causing PH, because of PH. There may be S3, that is because of the increased blood flow during diastole across the mitral wall, and may be associated with the diastolic rumble. And S3 is generally associated with acute LVS. Systolic murmur in MR is generally commences generally immediately after a soft S1, and may continues beyond or may obscure A2. Since the LA and LV pressure difference is maintained, systolic murmur is also related to the effective orifice area. Since in mild MR it is seen as the LV contractility increases, the effective orifice area, since the LV after, when the LV contraction, when the LV size increases, LV size decreases, the effective orifice area or orifice area is reduced. So in mild MR it is generally seen there is early in mild MR or acute MR there is early systolic murmur is seen. However, since the LV size increases in late decompensated MR, so the intensity of the MR, the murmur of the MR becomes more becomes holosystolic, as the size of effective regurgitant orifice area is not able to decrease since the LV size is large in chronic decompensated MR. So in such cases, the murmur is holosystolic and late decompensated MR. There is also in holosystolic murmur is also seen in rheumatic heart disease, since the etiology is because of the involvement of the D-plates, and it remains stable throughout the systole. So holosystolic murmur is also seen in rheumatic heart disease. So we have to differentiate. So the characteristic of this systolic murmur is flowing high pitched, heard loudest at the apex with the frequent radiation to the left axilla, left infrascapular area, and left infrascapular area, which is generally associated with posterior directed jet, and radiation is towards the sternum or aortic area. If the jet is anteriorly directed and posterior leaflet is involved or associated with MVP. So how will we differentiate the murmur of AS with the systolic murmur of AS and MR? In AS, there is generally beat to beat variation of the MR is seen, while in beat to beat variation of the murmur is seen in AS, while there is no beat to beat variation of murmur is seen in MR. There is late systolic murmur with systolic click is seen, is heard in MVP. Early systolic murmur may be seen in acute MR or mild MR, mild chronic MR. And holosystolic murmur is seen in rheumatic heart disease and chronic decompensated MR.
So Mayank, on basis of clinical features and your physical examination,
Yes, sir.
What would be the differentiating points between mitral wall prolapse MR and an organic MR?
Sir, so in mitral wall prolapse MR, there is generally associated late systolic murmur with mid systolic flick. In organic MR, we generally see early systolic murmur or
holosystolic, no?
Holosystolic murmur. Early systolic murmur in cases of mild MR.
Acute MR when the pressure gradient.
Or late systolic murmur. However, sometimes if the LV is too much dilated, sometimes there may be no murmur seen with the organic MR also, sir. जब एलवी और एलए के प्रेशर ऑलमोस्ट सेम ही हो जाते हैं तो मरमर नहीं आते और फिर उसके बाद डायनामिक ऑस्किलेशन से डिफरेंशिएट कर सकते
हैं ऑटोनॉमिक सिम्टम्स ही मैटर प्रोलैप्स में ज्यादा कॉमन होंगे तूने बताया ना
ज्यादा कॉमन होंगे हां ब्रेडी अर्डिनिया
में पैल्पिटेशंस और ये सब ज्यादा कॉमन उसमें होंगे
बट सर जो एक स्टडी थी इसमें मेरे को स्टडी का नाम नहीं पता उसमें था कि वी कैन नॉट डिफाइन the symptoms of MVP with autonomic dysfunction though it is associated with MVP is generally associated with
lekin main to exam ke liye bol raha hu agar tere ko pucha jaye ki age group aur baki features ke basis pe agar tere ko dono mein se ek DD dena ho to kisko upar rakhna hai kisko niche uske liye hai na
yes
sir ha presentation ka
yes so and on dynamic auscultation MR murmur generally decreases with the sudden standing from squatting position sudden standing from sitting position and squatting decreases however it is reversed in the MVP in MVP one more thing is important the appearance of the difference of the murmur and systolic flick in relation to the S1 and S2 so in Valsalva malmur it was seen it is seen that MVP clicks may occur earlier in systole with the lengthening of the murmur. From standing to squatting position, the MVP murmur and click may move forward towards the S2. So it is generally so the concept of this is the MVP murmur occur early in cases when there is increased contractility and decrease in end systolic volume and murmur and to differentiate murmur of MR from valvular AS. The murmur of MR usually intensified by isometric exercise, while the systolic murmur of valvular AS and obstructive HCM are reduced with the isometric exercise such as hand grip. So, the differential diagnosis for various systolic murmur is VSD. The murmur of VSD is generally seen in left lower sternal border. And it is not associated with left lower sternal border. The murmur of PR is it is associated with the apical thrill PR murmur is generally seen in left secondary intercostal space. And differentiated between AS platform and AS. Diagnostic testing for initial diagnosis. So transthoracic echocardiography indicated as a baseline evaluation for LV size and function. Cardiac MRI is indicated in patient with chronic primary MR to assess the LV, RV volumes and function when it is not properly addressed by transthoracic echo. Exercise treadmill testing can be useful in patients with chronic primary MR. In chronic femoral MR in which the patients are in patients who are asymptomatic and is class 2A indication. In chronic secondary MR, transthoracic echocardiography is useful in establishing the etiology of chronic secondary MR and extent and location of the wall motion abnormalities and to assess the global LV function. Other non-invasive imaging that are class 1 indications can be cardiac CT angiography, stress nuclear imaging and cardiac catheterization through coronary angiography.
Mayank, X-ray ECG pe aa jate hain, phir 6 o'clock bhi class hai na shayad, to aaj hai wali Friday ko hai?
Sir, kal, aaj kal hai wo to.
Achha, theek hai.
Characteristic of MRJ, sir, ab to bas mainly eco wala hi. So, there is evidence of...
Eco to hum ek alag se class karenge, puri sare valves, theek hai na?
Achha, so stages of...
Severity.
Then stages of primary MR. So at risk MR, mild withdrawal thickness.
So you only tell what are the severe MR ke changes. Baaki chhod.
Central jet is more than 40% of the LA. There may be associated hollow eccentric jet of the MR. Vena contractor may be greater than 0.7 cm. Regurgitant volume. Ye to sab cheez dikhi hui.
नहीं तो इसमें ऐसे ही पूछते हैं what are the quantitative, what are the semi quantitative and what are the qualitative factors. वो बता ना.
अच्छा क्वालिटेटिव तो इफेक्टिव रिगर्जिटेंट ऑरिफिस एरिया रिगर्जिटेंट फ्रैक्शन एंड रिगर्जिटेंट वॉल्यूम और मेनली सर ये सब क्वालिटेटिव है और क्वांटिटेटिव
ये क्वांटिटेटिव है.
अच्छा
क्वांटिटेटिव आर रिगर्जिटेंट वॉल्यूम रिगर्जिटेंट फ्रैक्शन एंड इजेक्टिव इफेक्टिव
रिगर्जिटेंट ऑरिफिस
एरिया ये क्वालिटेटिव है और क्वांटिटेटिव सेंट्रल.
अच्छा फिर सेमी क्वांटिटेटिव है वीना कॉन्ट्रैक्टर. ठीक है,
वी कैन क्वांटिफाई द वॉल्यूम ना.
और फिर क्वालिटेटिव में बहुत सारे आते हैं कि आपकी पल्मोनरी वेन के अंदर
रिवर्सल
दिख रहा है, एलए आपका डायलेटेड है, आपकी ई वेलोसिटी मोर देन 120 है, बहुत सारी चीजें हैं.
ठीक है, मैं बता सर ई वेलोसिटी मोर देन वो उसका जो रिस्ट्रिक्टिव फ्लो मोशन रिस्ट्रिक्टिव उसकी अपीयरेंस देती है ई वेलोसिटी, वो सारा मैंने बताया सर. ऊपर की
ये ना वो जो गाइडलाइन है ना इको की उसके अंदर अलग से दे रखा है कि व्हाट इज क्वांटिटेटिव क्वालिटेटिव. ठीक है,
अच्छा वैसे
फिर इसमें थ्योरी में एक क्वेश्चन पूछते हैं कि तुम पिज़्ज़ा मेथड पे शॉर्ट नोट लिखो. ओके, ये हाउ टू कैलकुलेट इफ ये
पिज़्ज़ा मेथड मैंने पूरा एक्सप्लेन किया. एआरओ रिकर्जिट वॉल्यूम
बिना कॉन्ट्रैक्टर में केवल दो ही चीज बताएंगे कौन से व्यू में देखते हैं.
तो